This example of refrigeration cycle is analyzed that uses Freon-12, and the cycle is shown in the diagram of the log of the pressure versus the enthalpy. And so this particular cycle uses a throttle valve, so going from point 4 to point 1 in this direction. At this point, we have a saturated liquid. We go through a throttle valve, constant enthalpy. We lower the temperature, and we get a mixture of liquid and vapor as a result. Cycle from 1 to 2, of course, is where we add heat from a lower temperature. Object the refrigerator. Cycle from 2 to 3 is where we're adding work to the process. And then from 3 to 4 is where we're giving off the heat so we can complete the cycle, get back to a saturated liquid. This particular example, at the data points, the enthalpies in BTUs per pound and the entropies in BTUs per pound per degree Fahrenheit are given, and these are from a table. And the objective is to calculate the heat transferred at low temperature and at high temperature. In other words, calculate QC at low temperature, QH at high temperature. Calculate the work input going from 2 to 3. This is the compressor, and this is the throttle valve. And also calculate the coefficient of performance, which is some indication of how efficiently this work of the compressor removes heat from the low temperature. And then finally, calculate the coefficient of performance if the compressor is only 70% efficient. So if you look at the data given, the entropy 3 is the same as the entropy of 2. In this diagram, this is reversible compression. And since it's adiabatic, this means that delta S is 0 for the compression. So some of these calculations are fairly straightforward from the diagram. QH, there's no work in the process going from 3 to 4. We're giving off heat at constant pressure. H4 minus H3 is equal to QH. We can read the values for the enthalpy. These are BTUs per pound. And so QH then is minus 63.45 BTUs per pound. Realistically, more than sufficient number of significant figures. And as a check, this is negative, as it should be, because we're removing heat from the system at the high temperature. Similarly, to calculate QC, QC is H2 minus H1. So QC is approximately 52.2 BTUs per pound. And this is positive because we're adding heat to the system. The next calculation is work. So work is only in the compressor stage. The compressor does work on the fluid. That's this stage. This is only heat transfer, no work. This is heat transfer, no work. This, there's no work and no heat transfer. So it's adiabatic, irreversible expansion, constant enthalpy. So I can get the work by two methods. The work should be the difference in these enthalpies. So H3 minus H2. The other way I could look at it is QC plus QH plus W must equal zero, because we're going around the cycle, and so the net change in energy for the fluid is zero because it keeps returning to its initial condition. So all the energy inputs and energy removed must add to zero. So if I think of the net energy for the cycle, there's only three energies that we add or remove. So this means the work is minus QC minus QH, 52.15 minus QH, and QH is negative. So the work is 11.3 BTUs per pound. And this is positive. As we expect, since we're adding energy to the system, the work should be positive. As I mentioned, we could also get the work as H3 minus H2. In the refrigeration cycle, all the energy that we add as work goes into increasing the enthalpy. And if I read the values off the figure, 87.5 and 76.2, I get, of course, the same value, 11.3 BTUs per pound. The coefficient of performance is defined as QC over W. You can look at this as this is what's desired for a refrigerator, and this is what we have to input, what we have to pay for. So the coefficient of performance, 52.15. This is BTUs per pound. The work, 11.3 BTUs per pound. So this indication of how efficiently we use the work, in other words, for every unit of work we put in, we transfer 4.6 units from the low temperature, which is our objective in a refrigerator. By comparison, if we look at a Carnot cycle, we could calculate the coefficient of performance for a Carnot cycle, and that's just related to the low and high temperature. So the low temperature in absolute units minus the high temperature. So low temperature is minus 10, and then we add 459.7 to make it degrees Rankine. Since we're looking at temperature differences, we don't actually have to use the absolute temperatures. So 449.7 over 80 is 5.6. So the best we could do between this high temperature of 70 degrees, this low temperature of minus 10, the best we could do is 5.6 if we ran a Carnot cycle between those. So the final part of this problem is, let's say, suppose that the compressor, where we're adding work, is only 70% efficient. Then that means that we have to put more work in, and we actually would have something going to the same pressure. We'd be at a higher enthalpy, put more work in. And, of course, we also would be at a higher entropy, because right now the original process from 2 to 3 is a reversible constant entropy because it's adiabatic. So we'll call this new point 3 prime. So the work for irreversible turbine, something 70% efficient, compressor, work for a compressor, is the work, the reversible value divided by the efficiency. Now we're just going to take more work to carry out the same amount of pressure change. So we have to add 16.1 BTUs per pound. And this means if we were to calculate the coefficient of performance for the irreversible compressor, again, QC over work irreversible. QC has not changed. 52.15, 16.1. So we have a significantly lower coefficient of performance. Of course, QH has also changed in this process. And our delta H irreversible compressor, delta H irreversible is going to be H3 prime minus H2. So this means H3 prime is 16.1 plus H2, so it's 92.3 BTUs per pound.